So the reason I thought it would be important to walk through this, I want to show you guys a little bit, like just the musings that I've been going over. You guys can take this, use this where you want to in your worlds. And human design is beautiful for the mechanics, right? It's the mechanical piece. But we forget about the esoteric or the ether or the field of potential or source energy. Some people call that God, whatever your connection is with it. And we forget that it still plays a part in this, even though Ra always talked kind of negatively around God. There's a there, you know, we know that we're in this field of potential, this energy field or the consciousness field, whatever you want to call it. We don't really have words for it. Scientifically, they really haven't quite proven it yet, but it's there. It's like the spooky energy, right, Tim? I think you call it spooky energy quite a bit. That
Spooky
is available.
action at a distance. Yeah,
Okay.
Einstein. Yeah.
Okay, there you go. Spooky action at a distance. And I just want to bring to you guys today for our first kind of touch on this and day one is the concept of self. And also the mechanical piece, how I see it, so you guys can walk away from this and play with this. And I want to leave you, I think everybody here got the concept of self PDF. Gidas, you can confirm or deny that. But I think that that was all sent out to everyone, so you guys can play in that energy.
Yes,
Tim, they did? Okay, excellent. Tim, I'm going to let you like make sure that anything in that chat that I need to be aware of that you'll let me know, or in the Q&As. So I'm going to share my screen so that you guys can, so that we can just take a look at this. All right.
I'm just trying
Hopefully
to chat things started.
you're just trying to figure out the chat. Is that what you said, Peter?
Yes.
Okay. All right. So first, I just want to let you guys see who I am energetically so that you know who is here teaching you. Tim, I didn't pull up your chart. I'm so sorry. That was terrible of me to not do that. Oh, okay. So if we were to just look at the lens, through the lens of human design, through like the mechanics, the second quarter is all about manifestation. That is the whole point of building form and creating this 3D Maya. And the process, all like the entire second quarter wants to move through the throat center. Okay. Everything wants to get to the throat center because what it wants to do, what we're going to talk about tomorrow, is this transmutation of energy. Okay. Everything wants to, like the neutrino ocean is coming through you, the field of potential, the consciousness field, God, whatever you want to call it. It's all moving through you so that it can be transmutated from just a frequency field into the 3D world. And in human design, there's this, I guess maybe I would say it's a misconception that only manifestors can manifest, or only manifesting generators can manifest, which is totally incorrect because the entire second quarter tells us that we all have the capacity to manifest. It is just how we are going to do it. How we are going to do it looks different for everyone because we are all unique. Okay. So the word manifestation actually means to discover or disclose, to make palpable or evident. It's the action of disclosing what is secret, obscure, and unseen. So how I see this, and you guys can put this in the Q&A or make your comments once the chat is open. You guys will have access to chatting as well, and Tim will follow that. What Neville Goddard indicates, I don't know, I think I've talked about him on a lot of my YouTube videos, and I'm guessing quite a few of you guys have seen the YouTube videos. Neville Goddard says creation is finished. And what he is meaning by that is in the field of potential, in the consciousness field, God, source, whatever, everything is available to us. Everything is, because it all has to start energetically. And the interesting part about design is that it teaches us that the very first quarter is all about mind. And yet, Ra always said the mind basically is the enemy. So today we're going to talk about that a little bit. I'm going to flip your thought process around that so that you can recognize that mind is not the enemy. And I'm going to show you the way to tap into your monopole and receive better so that you can upgrade your sense of self and your concept of self. So I just want to make sure I have everybody following. Everybody's okay, Tim. Any major questions happening there?
No, at the moment, people are saying they've not really received the PDF. So just like it is now. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah,
I'm working with that. I'm working with it.
Yeah.
Okay. Awesome. Okay. Awesome. Could you point us to the PDF? Okay. Where was I? All right. So with the field of potential, that's what I call it. I call the field, that ether field, the field of potential, because everything is there. However, nothing is there because it's not going to be there until it translates through us and is transmutated through our energy field so that we can make it palpable in this 3D world. Okay. So, what I love the most about human design, okay, what I love the absolute most is that human design teaches us decision making. And manifestation begins with a decision. It's up to you to make the decision on what it is that you want to manifest in your life. Now, again, I want to pull you back into that mental capacity. We are designed to not allow for the conditioning field to make our decisions. We want to make it from a clear conduit of who we are. However, most of the time, that conditioned mind is kind of holding us back. It's making up stories. It's doing all the things and not allowing us to move forward. Okay. Which hence creates a concept that we have of ourselves. So, for example, maybe you're told that you're crazy if you start a business. What are you doing starting a business? Do you have a really good job? You're making really good money. Maybe you have benefits. Why would you want to quit all that and start a job? Or start a business. Now, all of a sudden, there's a conditioning field there. And guess what happens? Then your decision-making starts to be conditioned. So today, I'm going to pull you into a little bit of a different process so that you can lean deeper into making decisions from a space that's correct for you. You guys all are into human design. You know this. You know your own decision-making process. But now I'm going to take you one step farther. And we are playing with this right now in the mentorship group. And this is about making decisions from the desired state or the goal or the manifestation as though it's already complete. So again, I'm hoping that the chat's going to be able to open up.
Yes. And, so sorry to interrupt you, Leann, because we're using the first time Zoom. So is there any idea how enable? Because I just looks like it's enabled, but nobody can type, only panelists and host.
Right.
I'm trying my best and I'm struggling a little bit. So sorry guys about that.
That's okay. Okay.
Trying to find them.
The only way that people are coming through at the moment is in the Q&A. But people are repeating the same thing about the PDF. If we can just let them know that we're working on that at the moment, if people could just ease off on the PDF.
So is it possible to upload the PDF on the Q&A somewhere? Or?
Let's just see. If I can do that, just give me a second, you guys. Of course, I can't find it on my computer quick. Sorry, I should have had it handy. So basically with the concept of self, let's just go over it. I'll just chat about it. So we all know about the conditioning process, right? We all understand that when we have conditioning, there is, I'll just stop the share. We create an identity for ourselves based off of the opinions and beliefs that we have picked up along the way through our conditioning. So that is how most of us are picking up our own identities. Whether that identity in you, that G center, is defined or not defined, understand that there are at least a minimum of 1,080 different variations per every one of those gates inside of every gate. So not only when it's defined are you going to get you're gonna still have conditioning in there, because there's more open space than there is definition. So every time there is a conversation with someone and we accept their beliefs and their opinions, and we put it into the subconscious mind without filtering that, or without saying, no, I don't believe that, that's not my opinion. The moment that we accept those opinions and beliefs, we begin to create an identity about who we are around those opinions and beliefs. So would everybody agree to that? That's here. Do you guys understand that part of it? Is that the moment that we take on the conditioning and we start making decisions based off of those opinions and those beliefs of other people, now we are creating a decision-making process from a conditioned space. So once I find the PDF here, I'll make sure that everybody gets it no matter what. We'll make sure you guys get it, especially for tonight. I'd like you guys to do the homework at least and play with it. What that PDF is going to show you is to help you to start to decipher who am I being based off of those opinions and beliefs of that conditioning field. How am I making decisions based off of that conditioning field? That is part number one. Okay. Is it the PDF called Self-Concept and Goal Lifestyle Aspirations? Yes. Yes, Donald, it is that PDF. Because the moment that we set forth into our experiment and play around in that, the deconditioning process is step number one. Ra has always talked about how we want to decondition. So we want to go into all of the openness. We want to look in those spots and start to get very curious. Okay. Very curious about how and what we are believing in those opinions that are sitting in there. Now, I want to show you an image, Gides. I think you can enable only as a host. Oh, goodness. How the heck am I going to do that?
I think there should be like a feed door somewhere, and to enable, because I enable to my own settings and make just all can chat with everybody. And but I think, yeah, if you can just, sorry about that. If you, and in terms of PDF, I'm trying to send again.
Sorry, guys, we're just trying to get the chat figured out.
I see them. Janine just says chat has been
Yeah,
enabled
it's
for me.
working
It's
now.
working.
The
Is
chat's
it? It's
working.
working now.
Oh, oof, there we go. I
So
have
are
no idea.
people using the chat or the Q&A? So to
So
keep
if you
an
guys
eye on.
want questions, if you guys want questions answered for Tim, ask the questions in the Q&A. If you guys are posting in the chat just as comments and playing in there, we'll post in there. But if there's a deep Q&A as we're walking through this and you want me to answer that at the end, put that in the Q&A. If you want to just have a chat and have that available here and kind of comment there, we'll leave it in the chat. How's that? Does that
Yeah,
work for you, Tim?
PDF will be, yeah, we're gonna send in the chat PDF soon.
Okay. Awesome. All right. Okay. Now, I'm just going to continue on to play here in some of this material. All right. So, the other thing I want to share with you guys is you might be questioning, like, what is the field of potential? So, we will go to that and we will play in that. So, the field of potential, in my view, okay, if I look at how the human design genealogy works based off of Ra's material, and this is coming right from his Rave Anatomy course, he talks about how the reflector was the very first energy field, and then the manifesting generator came into configuration. The manifesting generator birthed the generator, the manifester, and also from the manifester came the projector. So when I look at the field of potential, I look at if we were to have the mandala completely cleared off, it's a reflective energy. It's always going to reflect back to us our own concept of self. Our own concept of self, and we're going to keep continuing on with this theme, comes from the conditioned beliefs and that subconscious mind, and how we store all of this stuff in our concept, our subconscious mind. Okay. So what that reflective field will do will always reflect back to us. What is in the subconscious mind? What beliefs and opinions are we holding? However, what I also want you guys to dabble in and just play in and just meditate on this information, okay? This is not me say telling you exactly what this is. This is for you to take this these concepts and kind of let them brew in your own cellular structure and see how your manifestation changes based off of this. The other part of the field of potential is if we were to color in the entire mandala, everything colored in, we come up with an emotional manifesting generator. And what do we know about manifesting generators? We know that manifesting generators are here to respond. So not only will the field of potential reflect back to you the beliefs and opinions that are stored inside the subconscious mind, what's going to happen is that it's also going to respond to that concept of self. It is going to respond to how you're speaking to yourself and how you are speaking your story, how you're telling your story. It's going to constantly respond back to you. So if the language is very crude and crass and living in this dense energy field, then the field of potential is going to reflect that back, but also respond to that. Now, what we don't know about manifestation, okay, what we don't know about manifestation is the timing. Timing's always the factor, because we do not know the interval of time between that questioning or that asking of the universe and when it's going to show up, because it's emotional. There's a time interval there. Okay. So I just want you guys to play in these mechanics. Is there anything that you want to bring up, Tim? Anybody saying anything that?
No, at the moment, it's just the PDF. We've got the PDF. So what we're going to do is we'll put the PDF link in the introduction, you know, the information box. Is that okay? And then people can download it once once the video's gone live. Would that be okay? Or do you need it within the...
You can put it in the chat right now too, I think.
Yeah, Gittis has tried that, but we can't send it to all in the chat. So there's a difficulty there.
No worries. I will generate a link. Give me just a second. Give me a second.
Okay. Okay. So do you guys have any questions about, like, looking at this through the genealogy, understanding that the field of potential not only reflects back, but it also responds? And now you might go, but what about the other types, Leann? Well, the other types are all built in here, but we're always looking at, if we have the mandala completely clean, it's a reflective surface. If we color it right in and everything is available to us, it is responding through time to our requests. Okay. So now let's play around with the beautiful law of consciousness. So do you guys recognize this image here that is from the definitive book of human design, The Science of Differentiation, through Linda Bunnell and Ra? So Ra always talks about be passenger consciousness, right? He's always, you know, hammering in be passenger consciousness, which is our personality crystal that's sitting in the back of the limousine, and it is watching life go by. And he talks about the vehicle, of course, the design crystal, and that, you know, your meat suit, how it's designed to be healthy and well, and the cellular structure should be clean. And that happens through primary health system. That also happens through correct environment. So that vessel, your limousine, can be, you know, in tip-top shape so that your passenger can look around and watch, okay? But now in this course, in this process today, we're going to talk about the magnetic monopole and the driver quite a bit, because all of this is us. The magnetic monopole that sits right here in the G center, okay, there is a frequency and an energy field that is emanating off of that. It is also holding us together. So are you guys aware of what a torus field looks like? So basically what a torus field looks like is that it's constantly flowing energy to and through its center all the time. And it just creates this continuous loop that goes around and around and around. So if that self concept is one where you don't believe that clients are going to buy your offers, you have an opinion about how much money people will or will not spend on your offers. If you believe in that subconscious mind that maybe your offers aren't as good as the competitors, so they're probably going to buy the competitors. All men are terrible. They're bad. They're narcissistic. Parents are, you know, they didn't know how to parent me. And there's all these beliefs and stuff created there. There's a lower density frequency that starts to flow through your magnetic monopole. And the whole point of the magnetic monopole is actually to hold the personality and the and the design crystal together, and also attract and magnetize all your life experiences to you. But like I said in the last slide, it will only reflect back to you and respond to the frequency that's held inside your monopole. If it is one of disbelief, self-destructive thought patterns, beliefs, and opinions, then the consciousness field only understands a vibration. This is a law of vibration. Has no other choice but to bring you exactly what you're vibrating as. So as we walk through this and look at how we also want to really have a huge connection to our monopole, to our driver. Now, this is totally going against everything you've learned in human design, because Ra's always talking about passenger consciousness. Just sit back. However, if you just sit back and you are letting, let's just lean into that next image, you're letting the opinions and beliefs of all the party bus people sitting inside your limousine, if you're letting that give all of the directions to the driver, the passenger will always be distracted. The monopole will have this density to it because there is too many people between the passenger witnessing everything and the driver moving the limousine. There's too many different backseat drivers happening there. And because of all of that density, and those backseat drivers saying, yeah, I want to go forward. Yeah, I want to earn $1 million in my business this year. But then all of a sudden you find yourself self-sabotaging. All of a sudden you're going back to these like old patterns. It's because in the subconscious mind, these backseat drivers have zero faith that the driver knows where to go. They don't have any faith. So they start telling the driver, yeah, let's go, let's do this. So the driver puts on the gas. And then all of a sudden, another one of the party people says, whoa, we're not ready for this. Slow down. Oh, I don't believe in my offers. Hold on a minute. I can't do this. Oh, my mom told me that I shouldn't do this. Oh, my husband doesn't believe in me. And then the brakes go on. Now, all of a sudden, the wheels on the limousine are just spinning and the passenger's going, like, what's going on here? How come there's nothing new to see? Are you guys picking up what I'm laying down here? Is that understanding that subconscious mind, depending on what's in it, and this is what we do in our mentorship, is we deprogram that subconscious mind and reprogram it with the best version and the best self concept that is available to you. Because these party people will continue to dictate to the driver, hence the conditioned mind, where you should be going, what you should be doing. If you would do this, then we could have that. And all that is our opinions and beliefs that have been embedded. Kim, are there any questions?
No, we're clear.
We're good. So if you guys were to just pop open that PDF, did it get in there, Tim? Did the PDF get in there?
Yeah, somebody's provided a link and everyone's downloaded it, I believe, but it's there in the chat. Yeah.
Okay, cool. Awesome. What you're going to notice in there is that I lean into, and that was probably Donald that did that. So thank you. Donald's part of the mentorship coaching team. So that's awesome.
It was a lady called Laura, actually.
Oh, Okay, that's
Laura
Gidas's,
Bill Snowink. Yeah.
okay, that's Gidas's assistant. So good. So when we as entrepreneurs,
So,
I think Leanne's frozen.
I am.
You're back. You're back. You froze there for a moment, Leanne.
Oh, okay. Sorry about that. What did you hear, Tim?
Hey, you were
Your
just starting a sentence at that point.
Okay.
As we entrepreneurs, you said, as we entrepreneurs, and you said the same thing.
That's gone now. It's gone. Let's go to the next image. This is the image that I love the most. This is a part of Hebrew mysticism. Tim, you should you probably recognize this as well. This is a part of the differentiation degree. So when you guys look at this image, the most important part here is that we do not want to be making decisions from our current state, from our current circumstances. And you might go, I don't understand that, Leanne. Why wouldn't we make decisions from our current circumstances? Because our current circumstances are how we were acting and behaving and thinking from yesterday, last month, 6 months ago, a year ago. So all of that process manifested this particular moment. So if you are making decisions from right now, your circumstances that are around you are making decisions from a past self-concept that has yet to evolve. So in the mentorship group, I'm challenging them right now to lean into making a decision from the self-concept that you are already the entrepreneur that you desire to be. Maybe that's $1 million a month, maybe that's $1 million a year. That you are making decisions from a space where you already have the relationship. It feels good. You trust that relationship. The connection is fun and it's exciting and it's honest. So you want to make decisions from that space. You want to make decisions as though you already have the family and the children and the relationships with your parents, maybe your siblings. So if we're making those decisions based off of the outside 3D world, and we start to lean into the imaginative space, and that's where we're going to go next. Because Neville Goddard has indicated that with imagination, know that you are connecting to a field of potential, that everything is available to you. So when you make decisions from that space that everything is available to you. Now, what you do is you transform your 3D world because you're operating and making decisions from a future state of self-concept. Is that clear for everyone? And I might be pushing some of the limits here on your minds. And some of the belief systems that, human design kind of drops into us. But human design is human. It's for this 3D world, us walking around in this particular space and time. We want to take our imagination out into the ethers, break through the limitations of the subconscious mind, make decisions from that expanded space. And then drop them here into our 3D world so that when we are manifesting, it becomes a simple process because we've already played with it in the imagination. We've already made decisions from it in our imagination. And now, when we drop it into this 3D world, it can all be available to us. Tim, is there anything there?
Yeah, I have a question from our good friend Donald. Is there anything we can use in our designs to help us lean into our imagination?
Yes, Donald. So Donald, again, is a part of the mentorship group. I pull you guys over into the cognition. So into your tone of the design, sun, earth. You guys will want to go into the tone of your design, sun, earth, and lean into, whether that be taste, smell, outer vision, inner vision, feeling, and touch. So does everybody here know their cognition? Tim, is there anybody that doesn't?
No one's in the Q&A. Let me flip over to the chat. I'm just trying to balance both at the moment. Yeah, there's quite a few people speaking of inner vision, outer vision, touch. So yeah, people are responding.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, perfect. Donald, I love this question. Thank you. So as you guys are leaning into your imagination, what's going to be important, okay? What's going to be super important for you is to go to that cognition. And while you're in your imagination and you're playing out in the field of potential, you want to train the cellular structure, okay? You want to train the body, the cells, to recognize what that manifestation is going to taste like, smell like, feel, look like. What's it going to, when you touch it, what's it going to touch? What is that sensation of touch that you're going to touch? And I want you all to really go deeper into the tonal frequency, right? It's a triangle. And just like, I don't know if you guys did this as in band when you were in school, but we had band practice and stuff like that. And there's that triangle and you use this little dingy thing on the inside, ding, 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 ding. Inside the triangle, it's called sound. Sound is frequency. So everybody, every single human being walking on this planet has frequency and sound as a universal energy field in the tone. And then from there, smell, taste, touch, inner vision, outer vision, they all are based off of frequency and sound. So I want you guys to tap into, go into the imagination and train yourselves to smell your business at $1 million a month. Did you upgrade your home? Are you in different auditoriums speaking? Maybe you're a day trader, so you get yourself a beautiful brand new computer and you can kind of smell the plastic of it. You want to use those sensations in the imagination so that you can now drop it down. Okay. Now, here's the other thing I'm going to show you guys is the monopole. The monopole resides in the second gate. The second gate is the most receptive. Okay. It's a very feminine energy. Now, I don't believe that there's 72 genders. I will just say that up front. There's two genders, lots of different sexuality, and there is a feminine and a masculine frequency that operate through us. Gate two tells us through the monopole, as the toroidal field, do you see this toroidal field? It goes in and out and flows through that receptivity. Your monopole is connected to to absolutely every dimensional frequency, right down from the first dimension all the way up to as high as there is. Your monopole is connected to all of that. However, the field of potential will only reflect back what frequency you hold about your own self-concept, and it will respond to that version of the self-concept that is available to it. Okay? So when you are leaning into imagination, know that this frequency field, this Taurus field, is running through you. Gate 10, how are you behaving? How are you governing and regulating your actions, right? Are you acting scared because you think you might fail? Third line energy. Are you scared because you actually think you might succeed? These are the things that PDF is going to help you start to go into, so that you can extrapolate, how am I behaving? Whether or not you have any of these gates in a defined or undefined, like I say, there's more conditioning, more openness than there is definition, because we only have 26 activations, right? 13 personality, 13 design. And there's 64 gates, and each one of those gates have 1,080 minimum variations, because Ra never brought into consideration the astrology piece of this. So we want to get really clear as we are imagining, as we are creating, because the second gate is, it's all about direction. It's about this receptivity. And then where is it going? Gate one. Gate one is concretizing, is kind of bringing down, you know, the creative moment. It's allowing that creative moment to flow from the receptivity, okay? So we want to look at, how are we behaving? How are we acting? Are we acting from that self-concept that told us we weren't good enough, that told us that we had to hurry, told us that we had to avoid confrontation? You guys might understand some of this language. It's all about the, you know, the centers and that not self activity. How are we leading ourselves? Okay. We are all designed to be self-led. Doesn't matter what type you are designed to be self-led. So what guidance are you taking from your imagination? How are you conducting yourself? Creating, to bring into being. This is the, you know, this capacity for us to receive all of this imagination and then bring it and be creative with it. What do we hear ourselves? How do we hear ourselves talk? How are we talking about ourselves? How are you listening to yourself? Do you give yourself time to listen? The innocence, not being harmful. Not being harmful in the way you articulate who you are and that concept of self. So that as that frequency flows in your Taurus field, if you have harmful language about yourself, then most likely you're going to have this reflection and response from the field that is quite harmful. Determination, action of definitely, what is that? Definitely, ascertaining. So I can't even say that, sorry. So the determination is about ascertaining. The 42nd gate is deeply entrenched in the discovery process. So it wants to ascertain in the discovery process. Of course, the two, that driver, that's the monopole. When we take a look back, which we will here in a second, when we look at, we think about the limousine, when we think about that personality crystal watching, we think about the vehicle being, you know, clean, the limousine's clean, the oil's in there, it's all gassed up. All the electricals, awesome. All of that stuff is going on. But most of the time, people are talking about the driver. And the driver has the view of, where are we going? He knows the GPS. He or she knows the GPS coordinates. They know all the roadside pull-offs that are going to happen. They're the one controlling the brakes and the gas. They're steering the vehicle. And we forget about this conversation in human design, and we don't want to. We want to lean into it. And where the driver gets its information and how it's connected is through the monopole. It's a multi-dimensional connection. Okay? Then 15, it's all about diversity. It's a variety, right? Some of us have a lot of logic, a lot of logical mechanics. But for the most part, I have not yet come across anybody that doesn't have at least one gate in abstract or a right pointing variable, which tells us that we need variety. As human beings, we need to have some variety, not just patterns. Patterns are excellent. So if you guys take the body graph and you put it together, like cut it in half and then put it together, like fold it together, you want to look at the correlation of the whole collective circuitry and notice that when for example, let's say the 2946 wants to discover, what is it discovering? Most of the time it's discovering a pattern of that 515. So those two energy fields go together and they blend and they move back and forth from each other. So while you're in your imagination, you want to look at, how are you behaving? How are you self-leading yourself? What are you creating? How do you listen to yourself? Can you innocently be non-harmful? Can you be determined to move into and ascertain what it is that you want to manifest in your life? Can you trust your imagination and be receptive to the GPS that the driver has punched into the system? And can you allow for variety to happen and this separateness, this uniqueness? Can you allow that to happen? And I'm not even sure what's on my next slide. Oh. So while you guys walk through, okay, I want you to understand that the tribe is not in here. The tribe is not a part of this frequency and this concept of self. Okay. Mostly the collective is going to be the one that's conditioning you. Can the tribe? Yes, the tribe can totally condition you. But it is not anywhere here in the monopole. Has nothing to do with the self concept. Okay. The tribe doesn't want you to be individualized. It will support you in being in the conformity of the tribe. But the moment that you step out and you lean into your own self-concept, there might be some backlash from the tribe, okay? So when you're looking at self-concept, know that tribal norms and tribal support, usually, I'm not going to say not, it's not always, but usually the tribe is not interested in you differentiating yourself. So if you're allowing for the tribe to hold you back, be aware of that. Look at that. Why are you holding yourself back? Okay. So again, I think my next slide really just indicates how when this Taurus field, okay, you want to be very aware of what is the vibrational and the frequency of the language that you're using when you are manifesting from your imagination. You want to be really aware that you're using frequencies that align to what it is that you want to bring down into this world, because it's all about frequency. And Ra teaches us that right there in the tone. Sound is right in the middle. Frequency is right in the middle. So the frequency of $1 million right now to you in your business, if there's subconscious training from your parents that has, you know, said, well, money's dirty, rich people are evil, all this kind of stuff, you have to get clear on that, because there's a frequency flowing, which is then going to stop the receptivity of that $1 million coming through you, because there's a whole bunch of blockages there. Yes, Tim?
Leanne, there's a couple of questions come in that I think you might like to elaborate on. Somebody's asking, any additional considerations for somebody with a completely open G center? And somebody's also asked about the if they've not got gates too active, which I've tried to answer, but I just think you could furnish a bit more fully. Thank you.
Yeah, you're very welcome. Guess what? I have a totally open G center. So anytime you see a totally open center, I'm going to just stop the share and speak here. Anytime you see a totally open center in human design, what Ra indicates is that totally open center has already amassed a great amount of wisdom about direction and about love. It's already got it. So here's how I use it. You can use your totally open G center however you need to, but I use it as a backup beacon. It really sources the field of potential for me at all times. I also have feeling cognition, just like Tim. So when I am entering into a space, that feeling cognition and that totally open G center provides me with so much information. Even though I might have responded to go to that place, as I'm walking up to that building, I rely deeply on my cognition and on that totally open G center to let me know right place, right people, wrong people. And whether or not you have gate two defined doesn't matter. Everyone has a monopole. Everyone has a driver. Everyone has an imagination. Okay? The other space I will pull you into is to know that channel 41 to 30. We know that the 41 is the start codon. So 41 to 30 indicates to you that everything that you're going to imagine, you want to contract down to one imagination at a time. One sensation, whatever that is in your cognition. And then in order for manifestation to flow with ease, that form to be transmutated through you into the 3D world, it is to allow for the fates, that gate 30, that you surrender it to the field of potential. Okay? Here's what's really important. I want you guys to write this down. Who you are being, your mechanics, and what you are designed to be doing or being, and why you are doing it, your value system, is what the field of potential is asking you to work on. How everything shows up is none of your business. When it's going to show up is also none of your business, but how you're going to interact with it is through your mechanics and through your decision making. Because you've already leaned into the imagination. You've surrendered it to the field of potential. Now you come back into your 3D world and you be that version of your concept of self that already has the $1 million flowing through their business every single year. You be that concept of the best wife, of an enjoyable family member, a high-valued employee, a leader, a coach, an entrepreneur, you are already operating from that, making decisions there, because you've already been playing in your imagination. And now when you drop into the 3D world, you allow for the mechanics and your monopole to bring that energy to you. It will show you how to get to that space through the correct questions and the correct energy vibration that you are being in that moment. And we're almost at an hour. Okay, so let's open it up just for maybe a couple minutes, because that's how Tim and I like to operate, for a few questions. I don't know. I don't think we can, through a webinar, bring people up. I don't know how that works. But does anybody have any direct questions right now? So first I'll give you the homework, okay? Use that PDF and begin to lean into who are you being to create your reality right now, to witness the circumstances of your thoughts, actions, and behaviors that happened yesterday that are creating today. And now you get to lean into touching your imagination, going into that imagination and bringing down that self-concept and the frequency of that self-concept that has the plenty, okay, has plenty of what it is that you truly want to manifest in this lifetime. Okay, that's going to be your homework, so that when we lean in tomorrow's transmutation of energy, we're going to look at a lot more of the mechanics through this and the quote unquote how it's going to show up in your world. Okay, so is there any I know you guys are raising your hands, but I have no idea like how to bring you on here in a webinar. I usually just use meetings. So if there's questions, let's do that, Tim.
There are no questions at the moment. I'm waiting anxiously for some to come through for you.
Okay. Anybody have anything that they want to bring up before we close our 1 hour here? This is, I usually go for like 2 or 3 hours. Our mentorship goes for 2 or 3 hours, but I don't want to over like bombard you guys with this information. Oh, thank you very much. I'd like to see an example of outer vision. Okay. So in your imagination, here's my experience with clients with outer vision. Let's do this. Okay. Is that while you're playing in your imagination, your eyes are actually open and you are already in a room that has quite a bit of beauty that already is stimulating to your outer vision. And then again, I don't have outer vision. I have feelings, so I close my eyes quite a bit when I lean into that. But outer vision people, taste and smell, I also notice that they more so keep their eyes open while they're playing in their imagination. Does that help you, Tressa? I think it was that asked that. Are you able to use your outer vision, like your eyes open, and also be in your imagination? Yes, Tim.
Jamie's asked, can you repeat the homework again, please? Can we just have a recap on the homework?
Sure. So there is a PDF that Lara is putting in the chat. And that PDF will help you lean into understanding what is the concept that you have about yourself in the moment. What do you tell yourself right now about yourself? So if you were to create an offer, maybe, you know, I'm going to use a generator, manifesting generator, because 70% of the world is that. Someone asks you for something and you respond and you start creating, let's say you create a PDF, okay? You've responded to creating a PDF so that you can help your community. And you get halfway through the PDF and you hear this little tiny voice inside your head. They're not going to like this. They're not gonna be able to use this. This is silly. This is stupid. That is a concept of yourself. And that concept mostly comes from opinions and beliefs that other people have, that is embedded in you. Maybe a teacher told you that at one time. Maybe a parent told you that. Maybe a friend told you that on the playground. And you believed it. So now when you go to take action through response, you're like, well, I feel like maybe I'm procrastinating. How come I can never get anything done? It's because there's these layers inside that subconscious mind, inside your limousine, that friend or that teacher or that parent is sitting in between the passenger and the driver and trying to do the backseat driving. So that PDF, that's what you want to lean into. What do you think about yourself from yesterday, the day before, the month before? Who do you think you are? Who do you believe yourself to be? And then you want to start creating a different concept of self. Of course, my people are going to love this PDF. They asked me for it. They're going to love it. Everybody wants this. I have thousands of clients walking into my business every single day, desiring the value that I put out. They drop their credit card immediately because they want to connect. So those are two different concepts of self. Yes, Tim.
There's some questions forming here. So Anna asks, can you give an example of how to use smell cognition?
I love smell cognition. So I had a client and she was into permaculture. Perfect. So she could imagine what she's building right now is this permaculture business where she goes in and, you know, like for me, it's almost like landscaping, right? But it's this process of permaculture that she's going to go in and do this with different people's yards. So I'm like, okay, while you're doing this, smell the sod, smell the flowers that you're planting. When you have the initial interaction with the client, like smell their frequency. You want to be able to smell everything in your imagination, smell coffee brewing. You might even want to smell like, ooh, what does a bad thing smell like? It smells like garbage, right? Maybe smell sour. So you want to lean into that. So when you're in your imagination, you know, I don't know what your big vision of your world is, but say you want to be a coach and you want to go on stage and you want to speak. Imagine yourself walking into the auditorium. What does it smell like when there's 10,000 people in there? Okay, what is the backstage or the green room smell like? Do they have fresh flowers in there? Does that make sense? I can't remember who asked that, Tim. But
it was a lady called Sarah, but our good friend Donald asked, if you have fixed G gates, does this mean you can be more fixed? And do you have any advice around this?
So how do I want to say this? You have a certain way. Let's put it that way. You have a certain way of being. So yes, it is a little bit more fixed. But again, there's so much more openness. There's so much more awareness. Even though there is a defined aspect inside of you, there's a ton of awareness in the openness. So even though, let's say you have the 15, right? Or maybe you have the 15, 5, and your life is designed to be in flow, right? It's fixed in there, okay? But your flow is going to change. As you mature in life, as you change your patterns in life, that fixedness is going to upgrade. It's always going to upgrade. So human design isn't static. There's always this maturing and this upgrading that takes place because we have different experiences. We change our way of being. So because we change our way of being, the mechanics also get lubricated and start to operate in a little bit different ways, right? Does that make sense, Donald? I could hear you shake your head. If you only have one gate and channel from the G center, is that the only one you rely on more? It's more of a fixedness, okay? You will be representing that energy field, and then all the rest of it is deeper levels of wisdom. Okay, so thank you for that question, Leah. Yes, go ahead, Tim.
Astrid asks, talking about tonal structure, is the tone of the environment a variable of importance?
Yes, it is, because it's also the body, and it's the environment. So you can use both. I pull people into the cognition because I feel as though we need to first train the physical cells in the body, so that when that environment shows up, whatever the tone in the environment shows up, that the body is aware of that as well. But it's clean, it's crisp, it's already relying on its own cognition, and it's not getting confused with the environment being the cellular process. Because the environment is designed to be on the outside of the skin back, and the cognition is the inside of the skin back. So we want to train those cells to lean into the cognition. So we'll go for about, I don't know, quarter after. Gitas, are you okay with that? Are you guys okay with a few more minutes?
Yes, of course, of course, of course.
Okay, awesome.
Of course, then, yes.
Okay, go ahead, Tim.
Okay, now asks, any comments on leaning into your HD cognition versus the general homogenized advice to visualize? In your experience, does it help to boost your cognition with other physical senses?
So again, I want to pull you back now into the middle of that tone, and it's all about frequency. So smell has a frequency, taste has a frequency. Visualization has a frequency, feeling has a frequency. It all has a frequency built right into it, a sound, let's say. Okay. So in the imagination, some people don't see. They don't see a picture, but they can smell, you know, I can take them back to a memory, let's say, right? And but we want to make this into the future. But I can take you back and say, okay, well, maybe there was something that your caregiver, your mom, your dad, whatever it was, made in the kitchen. Like my mom baked bread. And I remember after school, like even though smell is not my cognition, I can still tap into that sense of smell and go right in there and act as though I'm like in my mind, I can be right inside of my kitchen of my childhood home. So that's imagination. But mostly what we do, okay, mostly what we do is rely on memories that hold us back. We now want to take the imagination and future pace ourselves and train the cognition and the cellular structure from that future space versus where we were. How do I know what my cognition is? I do have that actually. I know Gidas on his bodygraphchart.com. I'm pretty sure you can get cognition there. If not, right on my homepage, www.powerofself.ca, you can grab your chart and get your cognition. Now, here's what's really important, you guys, as you walk through your experiment with human design, correct birth time is so important. Because what correct birth time does is like narrows down that substructure so that you are correctly connecting with that substructure. So tone, color, and base. Base, personality base is going to change every 9 seconds. So if you're not there with the stopwatch, personality base can get a little, you know, it might be a little skewed. Yes.
Okay, Nicole Howard has asked, I'm not sure what this is in reference to because you've spoken quite a bit, is could this be why my body reacts so adversely since I've been back in the corporate environment?
Am I there, Tim?
Yeah.
Can you hear me? Okay.
Yeah.
There's a couple things that I could say there. Corporate environment is usually quite tense. And if you've already started the deconditioning process and you go back into that tense situation and your body is starting to get pulled back into these old subconscious trainings, the body is going to shake. It's going to feel things. It's going to feel like, oh my God, it's getting bombarded by different frequencies that are more dense. Where as we start to decondition and we trust that process and we clean out the cellular structure, we begin to have a different frequency to our body. We just do. We're, 98% water, and doctor, what is it? Hamo, what is that doctor that does the whole water thing?
Oh, I forget his name. I know you
Yeah.
mean
Yeah.
Mikhail,
It starts with an H, doesn't it? Anyway,
Emoto.
yeah, something like that. Emoto. There you go. Thank you very much. Thank you. When you speak to the cellular structure in a way with love and all of that, then the crystals of the water, the crystals of your cells, all of that starts to have a different construct, structure. You go back into the corporate world, and there's just a different frequency in the corporate world. So your body is going to feel different. Things are going to feel different frequency wise. I don't know if I answered that or not, but water is a crystal. Yes. Think about ice. Exactly, Donald. All right. Anything else? We'll probably close here in 2 minutes. So tonight's homework, if you guys want to do your concept of self, then tomorrow we are going to talk about the transmutation of energy. So we're going to get into that openness a little bit, and play in there. I don't know if I will, we might bring up charts tomorrow. We'll see. We'll see how that works. Thank you. Oh, Mercedes, hi. This was fun. Excellent. Thank you. Is this recorded? Yes, this is recorded. And all of our bloopers in the very beginning are also recorded. Anything else anybody wants to ask? I'll give you one more minute. You're very welcome. I really appreciate everybody being here, and I hope that you I don't want you guys to believe in me. I want you to go play with this material and just lean into it and just start to imagine how this is moving through and to and through your physical bodies. Mental conditioners, more important than other openers. Mental conditioners definitely can be more important, Mercedes, because the electromagnetic is looking for the information on the other side. And because that hanging gate, that dormant gate is looking for that frequency on the other side, we can be more highly conditioned there. It's electrical, right? There's this electromagnetic that happens there. Hey, Gerard, what kind of impact will this have on my type of business that I should have? Gerard, I definitely have to look at the entire chart and lean into that, because there's more than just one space that we want to look at when we're looking at business and career and all that kind of stuff.